Are you new to EU4? Do you want to know what Europa Universalis 4 is? Or do you want to get better at the game? Then stay tuned. Hello guys, this is Flying Dutchie, and it is finally going to happen. I'm gonna do an EU4 tutorial for complete beginners, and I wanted to do this for a long time, and I think this is the right moment to do it. We are now in patch 1.30 in the Austria patch, where a lot of things has changed. And I think this is the right moment. We are in between two patches, so this is the right moment to start a beginner tutorial. And I wanted to do this for years, but let's start it finally. And let's explain everything that you need to know. And the goal is to get started in EU4 and that you know how to play it. Now, before we start, EU4 is a grand strategy game that you can pause, and if you compare it to, I don't know, to other games, it's really hard to compare because it's a real-time strategy game where you just pause the game if you have to. And I really wanted to make a tutorial series because I have over 3,000 hours in the game and I think I know a lot of things about it. So this is the starting screen of the game, and you can see the version here. I'm now at 130.4. And you can do single player, multiplayer. There's a tutorial, and I highly recommend you to play the tutorial before you watch this series. I will go over everything that the tutorial will explain you as well. But if you start with the tutorial, I think you have a bit of an understanding about the game. There's the credits, and there's the options, of course. Autosaves. I'm playing on 144Hz, on the highest graphics. I only have Bloom off, I don't like Bloom. Audio settings, control, accessibility for multiplayer. You can exit the game here. This is the, I think, the home page of Europa Universalis 4. This is the home page of Paradox Plaza. The Facebook page and Twitter. And here you can connect your Paradox account to the game. So, no further ado. Let's jump into the game here. So click on single player. And this is how the map looks like when you open the game. And as you can see, we are now in 1444. You can choose you can choose any starting date you want in this game, and click on a nation and play it. It doesn't matter. You can play as Fezzan. You can play as Yao. You can play as Ajuran. You can play as Ming. You can do whatever you want, and every nation has its own flavor. And that is the good thing about this game. These grayed out buttons are DLCs. There are 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16 downloadable content for EU4. And for the purpose of this this tutorial, I turned everything off. Because I think most of the people that want to watch this are not having any DLCs at the beginning. And I normally play with every DLC enabled. So it's going to be interesting to see for me what features I'm going to miss. And I will write these down on a paper. And then after the tutorial I will put a video there where I recommend the DLCs you should get. And I think that's a good way to see what I want to do. So yeah, you can just take a look around. And here are some starting nations that are really interesting for this time period. So the beginning date of the game is 11th of November in 1444, and the game ends in the 2nd of January 1821, if I remember correctly. But most of the times you don't reach that date, so it's not really necessary to know. You can click sometimes over here. Some timestamps are made by Paradox. There's the rise of the Ottomans. The Ottomans are also a really strong nation that you can start with. I think they are the strongest nation in the start of the game. If you click on it, you see a lot of information, but I will go over these things when we are in the game. And yeah, you can also do Empires of the Sand, and then you get recommended nations in Africa. The First Nations, you can play as a native tribe in the Americas. Incas or Aztecs or something else. You can do that. The fall of Byzantium, but now the date is 1453. You can play in any timestamp and start from there. For example, there is the Warlick of Cambrai. Some history about there, and the game is saying, hey, maybe you should play as France, or the Papal State, or Venice. As you can see here, the lowlands here, Belgium and part of the Netherlands, is now occupied by Austria. And that's historically correct. But when you start from a date and you click play, nothing is correct anymore, and the history is gone. Then the game will unfold itself. Maybe for the Americans here, there is the 4th of July, 1776, starting date. And let's see if the game loads it. There you go. You can play as the United States of America. And you will start at war with Great Britain. And with Newfoundland and the 13 colonies and the British West Indies. You can do that as well. So you can decide yourself which nation you want to play and from which timestamp. You can even choose to go one day before the 4th of July, for example. And there is no America. You can start at any date you want and any nation you want. That's just amazing. And normally you really start on the 1444 date. There are a couple of reasons. There are Steam achievements. That is a nice goal of the game that you can take. The goals you have to decide yourself in this game. It's not that when you conquer the world you win. Yes, of course. But conquering the world in this game is not a... not the main goal. It's to make a global empire and grow. You can also play tall, and that means that you can develop your land and not spread out that much. So you can play it in any way you want, actually. Now, you should not get these DLCs when they are not on sale. Promise me that you only get these when you are seeing a Steam sale for the DLCs, or go to humblebundle.com. Sometimes they have a package where you can get like 8 DLCs for $17 or something. 17, not 70, but 17. And that's really, really cheap. And you should not buy them for $10 or $15 each. At least not the older ones. That's not needed. But as I said, just play the vanilla game without any DLCs. And then you know... then you have more fun when you add a DLC, so you don't miss any features. And then when you add a DLC, you're like, oh, hey, that's nice to have. I think it's better. Now, I think that I explained everything that I wanted to do. There are a couple of map modes here, but we will go over these in the game. They are also visible in the game, and there are a lot of map modes in the game, and I will explain all of them. But yeah, we are going to start a game as Castile. I really think that playing as Castile in your first game is going to be the best choice. Maybe Portugal, but Castile is just, I don't know, they have some events, you can do colonization, because that's also a goal of the game, colonize the whole world. There are a couple of provinces here, for example, that you can colonize, and that's all over the world, especially over here. It's very empty. And yeah, that's also a main part of the game. So I would just click on Castile. And then we're going to play as Castile. First of all, we go over the game options. Oh, we went over this one already. Or normal options. Now, I did play a game on very hard, because I like to play on very hard. I would recommend you to play on normal. You could do very easy, but to be honest, playing as Castile and just do what I tell you to do, normal should be the way to go. You can do lucky nations off, for example, for your first run. You should not do an Ironman run. You should do a normal run. So you don't need lucky nations for these. Lucky nations are bonuses for nations that were normally very good in the history. For example, France will get this bonus. England, I think the Ottomans as well. And you can just turn this off to none, and that makes the game a bit easier for you. Dynamic province names is just when the names of the provinces go to your culture. If you play as the Netherlands, for example, the provinces in Belgium will have a Dutch name and not French. And the rest, yeah, I think you can just keep this on yes. Alright. We're gonna jump into the game as Castile. Now, as you can see, achievements cannot be earned. So Steam achievements, which are a nice goal to go for in most of the games, you can only do this when you have Lucky Nations on. And when you're on Iron Man mode. You can see it here. Lucky Nations option must be set to historical. Now we will do a normal game. The difference between Iron Man and normal is that a normal game, you can go back to an older save. You can save the game and if things go wrong, you can go back 10 years in time. But in Iron Man mode, you cannot do this. You can only go back 1 month or 2 months, I think. There is a cheating way you can still go back further, but we're not going to go over that. It's called birding. But just click on normal mode and click the play button. So there we go. The first time you should play as Castile, and I think that's the better choice. So it's initializing the game. And the music changes, and this is the overwhelming interface. And when you first play this game, you don't even know where you have to start, and I can understand that. So we will just go over them one by one. I will slowly explain everything you see at the start of your game on the map. And slowly but steadily, every episode I will add some information and we are going to play a bit. Now, when you start a new game, you get this nation pop-up. These are all the DLCs and we have disabled it, or you have not, or you don't own them. Maybe they are not visible then. But here you get some information about your country and the history of it. So we're going to read our country history. It's the Trastámaras and the Crown of Castile. Shaped in the battles of the Reconquista, the Crown of Castile is in fact not just one kingdom, but a union of the kingdoms of Castile, León, Toledo, Galicia, Murcia, Jaén, Córdoba and Seville under the Castilian branch of the Trastámara dynasty. What remains of the Moorish presence in Iberia is now restricted to the southern kingdom of Granada. Still a rich Muslim sultanate in many ways, but also marred by infighting and frequent border skirmishes with the Christian raiders. Surrounded on all sides by Castilian castles, it seems to be a matter of time before the Reconquista is brought to its logical conclusion and the kingdom is annexed. So that's going to be a goal at the start. We are going to annex this Granada nation. For now, however, Castile has problems of its own. The Castilian nobles and the local Cortes of the various constituent kingdoms still hold a large degree of power, and many Trastámara kings have found themselves at the mercy of the estates of their kingdoms. Factions acting entirely out of their own interests have not shied away from supporting foreign pretenders from Portugal and Aragon in the past. So these are yellow nations, these are bordering us in Iberia, in this peninsula. If the kingdom can be united by a strong ruler and the Reconquista completed, Castile will have a fearsome military force in its hands, with a long tradition of fighting for the expansion of the Christian faith. While Castile lacks the seafaring tradition of neighboring Portugal, they have just as good access to the Atlantic Ocean and the new trade routes that are opening up to the west and southeast. Okay, so looks like we have some Muslim state on the south and we should take care of that at the beginning. Now that is the country tab, there's a religion tab. We are Catholic. Almost everything at the start in 1444 in Europe is Catholic. And there are also religious mechanics, and every religion has its own mechanic. And you can also change religion, but we will go over that later. Now, we are the Catholics. The Catholic faith gives a tolerance of the true faith and tolerance of heretics -1. So people that are Catholic have more tolerance. People that are not Catholic, but are heretics, which is Protestant religion, Reformed, Coptics, some branches of the Catholics, I think. No, these are heretics. Those are not of the Castilian branch. So the Catholic branch. So these are Muslims, Hindus, Buddhists, Shintos, and that kind of religions. We don't tolerate them, and that gives unrest in our country. We can interact with the papacy and getting papal influence. We will go over that later. And you can see in the early start dates, most of the Christian world is Catholic. But over time, reform desire will build up and as a result of the eclectic actions of all Catholic rulers. Once reform desire is high enough, the Reformation will start and the Protestant and Reformed faith will start to spread rapidly from Centers of Reformation. When this happens, I will go over the details. We are a kingdom and a monarchy. That means that we have a ruler that will rule until he dies, and then the heir takes over. We also have estates, and we will go over estates, maybe not in this episode, because that's a 10-minute explanation on itself, so let's not bother by estates right now. And they can be loyal and they give bonuses, and that's the only thing you need to know for now. And the environment, we're not going to talk about the Holy Roman Empire, that's also for later. It's just a, if you want to read it, just pause the video, but just a environment update. We are here, and this is also in Europe, and this is also there. And then you can click close. You can zoom in and zoom out with the mouse wheel. You can scroll with your mouse to the sides of the screen. You can use the arrow keys that I like to use. And you can see that the map changes as well when you zoom out. You see Castile. When you zoom in, you see all kind of provinces. You can see armies. These are our armies. And this is our fleet. It's actually two fleets stacked on each other. And I think first thing I'm gonna do is explain what you see on the screen right now. So, this is your shield. You can click on this and then you go to the country, your country view, and you can do a lot of things over there. Here you can go to the production interface. We'll go over that later. Government reforms, you don't have to know anything about that right now. But let's start with the treasury. In this game, you get money. And with your money, you can buy buildings, you can buy armies, you can buy fleets. And yeah, that's actually the most important. Those armies and those fleets. And you can see that there is a taxation income of 8.8. And this is monthly. Production income, trade income, and gold income. And we pay for our state maintenance, army maintenance, fleet maintenance, and fort maintenance. And at the moment, we have a surplus of 11 ducats a month. It's good to know that the starting date, 11th of November, when you go to the 12th of November, and you can do this by using the spacebar, so press the spacebar now, that is your pause button, and you're going to use it all the time. So when I press spacebar, this will go to a play arrow. Oh no, it's going away. And now I pause again, and now we are at the 12th of November. This is your speed. With the plus sign and the minus sign, you can increase or decrease the speed. Normally you would play on speed 3. For the tutorial, maybe you should play on speed 2. And at the start I would play on speed 1. This is really low, you never use this almost. And it's very important to know that in between the dates, nothing in the game happens. So within the 12th of November, nothing can happen. If you go to the 13th of November, then things happen. So this game works with daily ticks. And there are also monthly ticks. On the 1st of every month, you get your income, for example. On the 1st of December, we get our 11 ducats and get added to the treasury. Now, what is also monthly is your manpower. Now, your manpower is what you need to reinforce your army and to build your army. If you want to build more armies, then you use 1,000 of the 8,300 here. But we'll go over that very soon, actually. We do gain 245 each month, which is not that much, but we will increase it over time by buildings and by developing our provinces and conquering. But yeah, that is your manpower. You have sailors in the game. That is the manpower for your ship, for your ships. If you build ships, you use sailors. And you also need maintenance when you use them for certain actions that we'll go over later as well. Then there is the stability. Stability can go from minus 3 to plus 3. And you can increase this in your country view that we will go over in the next episode. The higher your stability, the more bonuses you get. And when you are at plus 1 and you hover over here, you can see the bonuses in the tooltip. But since we are on zero, we don't have any bonuses or penalties. Then there is corruption. Most of the time you don't want corruption. And you get corruption by having by conquering land that is not yours, and you have to pay it down. That's one of the biggest corruption increases. Then there is prestige. For now, just remember, the higher the prestige, the better. It's a dynamic modifier that sometimes you cannot do a lot about. It comes by itself, by playing the game the right way. Then there is the legitimacy. And at the moment you can see that we have very nice bonuses from our 100 legitimacy. This can go down by events when you have a new heir that is not having a very strong claim on the throne. This is just telling you are the right ruler. You are the son of the king, so you should be ruling. That's how it is. And if you have an outsider coming to the throne, then yeah, you get a lower legitimacy. And people don't like that. And over here you have your power projection. Will also come over time when we do this. You get this by getting rivals. We'll go over that as well. And when you have 25, you get an extra leader. And when you have 50 power, you get plus one of these things. Those plus one paper, plus one bird, and plus one swords. Now, what are these three icons in this list? Those are these three icons. And this is your power. Your administrative power, diplomatic power, and your military power. You need this for almost everything that you want to do. If I conquer more provinces, I need to core the provinces by spending administrative power. If I have a personal union or a vassalization over another country, and I want to integrate him in my own realm and have the provinces for myself, you have to spend diplo power. Military power is needed for making generals. And it's also, you also need all these powers for your technology, which we'll go over later as well. Then there here is the Age of Discovery. This is normally a button, but since I don't have all the DLCs, you cannot do anything with this. And that's maybe good, because it's getting already too much, maybe. But don't worry. We will go over all the things slowly. Before we do any action, I will explain what I do. This is just an overview. But you cannot click on this. With a certain DLC, you can click on these age bonuses. And I highly recommend that DLC. I don't know which one that is, but I will find it out. Now, over here you have 0 out of 2 merchants available. Merchants do trade in the game, and they can steer trade to your home node. We will go over trade in maybe also the second episode. I think it's important. But for now, we are going to leave that alone. We have 0 available colonists out of 0. You need colonists to colonize other parts of the world. But you can only colonize when you do certain technology groups, or when you have a certain national idea. And we will go over that as well later in the game. But for now, we don't have any colonists. We cannot colonize. These are your diplomats, which are also listed here in the outliner. We have 3 diplomats that we can use. They can do all different kinds of actions, and I will explain these as well. You can see the 2 merchants are also listed here in this list. This is your outliner, and this is a very handy tool. You will use this almost all the time when you play the game. Also, the armies are listed here. The 13,000 army here and the 11,000 army here are listed here as well. And you can also click on these to activate them. And our 2 navies are here as well, and the players. So this is handy for your multiplayer game. You can also change all the options in the outliner. You can change almost everything in this game. You can display it how you want. Do you want all your provinces listed in the outliner? You can. But I don't use that. So maybe you should also not use it. Human players can go out, because we are doing single player, so let's turn that one off. You can put the estates here, but you can see all those numbers. Not gonna be bothered by that at the beginning. It's not really needed to play the game. So I have these options on. Maybe you should do the same at the start. That were our diplomats that we are gonna use soon as well. And then there is the missionary. Missionaries convert your provinces to your own religion. And we don't have to do that right now because everything we own is Catholic, and I will show that to you as well very soon. Now, this is a music button. You can open the playlist. If you have any DLCs, you have way more songs than this. You can adjust the volume. Next song, shuffle, context sensitive, shuffle on or off, shuffle on or off. Skip the next song, you can. This is the button for the outliner. If you don't want it, you can put it away, but I highly recommend you this to put on. These are the achievements, but we are not in Iron Man mode, as I told you before, so we cannot get any achievements. Then over here is a message box. In the one day that I skipped, two events happened from the nations that I assigned as interesting. Baden entered a military alliance with Austria. Alright, not really anything I care about, but Aragon, which is my bordering nation, entered a military alliance with Siena. Where is Siena? Click on it. Or right click on it and click on the go to the capital. There. So Aragon is allied with this tiny nation. Now you can change these settings how you want, but just keep it on default for the beginning. I always click this one on. And on this button, I click on best guess, so I get information from these nations. Bordering nations and nations that are interesting to me. And sometimes you can get some nice information here, but for the beginning, just ignore it. I think you can toggle it on and off here as well. I will keep it on. Before we go over this screen, this is the Holy Roman Empire screen. We are not going to be bothered by this because we are not in the Holy Roman Empire. And I will also not go over all these things here. If you know anything about the history of Europe, there was a Holy Roman Empire with all kinds of princes that were having independence, but there was a emperor over them. And yeah, not going to be bothered by this at the start of the game. And we have the papacy. We will go with the papacy because we are a very loyal Catholic nation. And therefore we get more papal points that we can use on certain bonuses. We go over that later as well. Now the last thing I want to talk about for this episode are the map modes. And there are so many map modes in the game. Right now, you see that the political map mode is gray or a bit dark. That means that we are now in the political map mode. Maybe when you have a new game, these are all empty. You can add map modes to the slots by right-clicking on one of the buttons and add another map mode. For example, on this button, shortcut O. You can use shortcuts, but I'm very clicky. I like to click the buttons. I have four map modes. Now, if I click on it, I go to the culture map mode of the world. Look at this. Do you see a difference in color? Those are culture groups. For example, Scandinavia has a Danish culture, Swedish, Norwegian, Sami, Finnish and Icelandic culture. It belongs to the Nordic culture group. We are having three cultures, maybe four actually. We have the Galician culture group, Leonese, Castilian, Basque, and Andalusian. There's also Portuguese, Aragonese, and Catalan culture. And on every part of the map, there is a culture assigned to a province. Now, if I click this button again, I go to another accepted culture map mode. If I click again, I go to the area map mode and the region map mode. So these are the buttons I have assigned to this this map mode button. But mostly you play on the political one. Another important one is the diplomatic. You should get this one also added to your list. Because this will show you in green what you own. And also when you have claims which you need to go to war, you will get stripes on the map. And then you know, oh, I have claims on that nation. It's very handy. The religious map mode is handy. at the moment you can see. Most of it is Catholic. There are some Hussites, some Orthodox cultures, religions, Sunni, Shia, Coptics. And in the south or peninsula, there is some Muslims that we want to drive back to Africa. Now, don't get scared, okay? Promise me you don't get scared. I'm gonna click this button, which you really need to have. Because when you play as Castile, trade is everything. Don't be scared, okay? Don't give up. Please don't go away. This is the trade map. And it's too early to explain what trade is because we don't even know how to go to war and stuff. So every part of the map is part of a trade region. Every province that you can click on, and we will very soon, is part of a trade node. And every trade node produces money, and those arrows are the giving the flow of money. For example, we are currently collecting in our home node in Sevilla. This is the Sevilla trade node. Also, the northern coast of Africa is part of it. There is 7.7 trade here, and we collect 4.8. If you hover over the treasury, you can see that we have 9.18, but that is because the game is not updated. Next month this will be correct. The first month this number is not correct, so we should not look at this anymore. But this is the trade map mode, and our merchants are steering trade from incoming nodes to the Sevilla node. You can see, for example, that the Savi trade node is having a Castilian merchant and a Portuguese merchant steering trade to Sevilla, which is our home node. Also, Castile and Portugal are steering trade from the Tunis node to Sevilla. And that is maybe the best thing you can do at the start. Just steer trade to your home node. So that was a trade map mode. I have a terrain map mode. I'm not using that a lot. Fort map modes, not really helpful. I think these are the most important ones. The diplomatic, religious, political, trade. Later on you need the colonial and trade regions map mode. You want the institution map mode, that we will talk about in the next episode. Coalitions, we will go over that as well when we are gonna finish a war. Maybe the culture and the accepted culture map mode is a nice one. State and territories. Now, for example, if you click on states and territories, which I go over in the next episode as well. Oh my god, I have so many things that I will do in the next episode. Hopefully I can make it in one episode. But yeah, these are the states and territories. You can see that there are stripes here in the tiny nation of Navarra. And that is because this is part of a state where I have two of the three provinces. Do you see this thicker border? That means that this is a state border. If I click on one province, we will go over this in the next one, then this is the province of Vizcaya, and this is the state where Vizcaya is in. And if you click on this one, you see that there are three provinces, two there are our core provinces, and one that is part of someone else. So this is the state of Vasconia. That is why we have striped here. We have this as a core state, but we don't own this province. So we should also make sure that we get this one at the beginning. Now, I think I have spoken enough for the first episode. And in the next episode, we are going to go over what you can do in a province. We will go over the country view, maybe the production interface, and what these things are. And then in the third episode, I think we will start playing. So, yeah, make sure to join the Discord if you're new to the game. I will put the link in the description. It's also in my YouTube banner. There are a lot of people that want to help you if you have any questions. And check out the other links as well. My Patreon if you want to support me. And my Twitch channel if I'm gonna go and stream. I will do it over there. And don't forget to like the video. And then I hope to see you in part 2. For the beginner tutorial of EU4. Hopefully see you there.